We want to thank you for joining us live stream on Facebook and YouTube. And we have some announcements to go through quickly for you who are here. We have this blue card. It's a prayer request card. If you or someone you know needs to be lifted up in prayer, just take it, fill it up. You can drop it in the offering plate on your way out this morning. And we want to thank you for your continued donations. You may drop off your tithe at the church office, or we can accept credit cards and e-checks online. And for you who are here, like I said before, at the end of the service, you can drop your tithe and offering off into the offering plate as you exit the building. Those are our announcements for this morning.
Hang on, Chris. We have a camera issue.
Every time she moved.
Heavenly Father, we thank serve. We thank you for the blessings that we enjoy each and every day. Lord, we lift up this great country to you and all the things that it goes through. And Lord, we just pray for the leadership of our country, our president, our governor and mayor, and also for the men and women, Lord, who serve and make decisions for us. Heavenly Father, we lift up to you the members and the citizens of this great country. Lord, in perilous times where there's much division and strife, Lord, you are the peacemaker. And Lord, we just pray for the peace that surpasses all understanding to bring us into unity, that we may be one nation under God. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who have served in our military and those, Lord, who are serving, because we have been blessed by their service. Heavenly Father, we lift up to you those who are sick, Lord, not just with the coronavirus, but there are many other people who are going through treatments, Lord. We lift them up to you this morning as well. Lord, those that would love to be here but can't because they don't feel well, or Lord, they feel like they're at risk. Lord, we just pray that you will open up the way for the church to come together. As it says in your word in Hebrews, Lord, that we should not forsake the assembling of coming together, Lord, to commune with you, to worship you, to encourage one another. For there is something about your people coming together in one place that you love very much. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church and its many facets of ministries. We pray, Lord, for our children's ministry, our youth ministry, our adult ministries. Lord, that you will put in the heart of each and every leader of these areas, Lord, a way to continue the ministries, Lord, during times like this. Lord, that we will be equipped, and that you will open doors, Lord, for us to walk through. Maybe we won't be the same church. Maybe we'll emerge from here as being a different church, but we will do so, Lord, being faithful to you and your holy word. Not changing it, not revising it, but Lord, submitting to it. Heavenly Father, we pray for our pastor and his family, that you will put your hand upon them and continue to love and give them the wisdom and knowledge and understanding, Lord, that is needed to be the pastor of this church in times like these. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who went to the cross and bore our pain and our shame. And without him, we would not be here today, but because of everything who he is, we are here, Lord. And we lift him up to you. Lord, teach us how to praise you this morning. Teach us how to sing songs this morning. Teach us how to pray. Teach us how to take the word and apply it to our everyday life, that we may leave these doors better than which we came in, living the life that becomes the gospel. And Heavenly Father, we just thank you for everything that your word teaches us and the truth that it stands alone. It doesn't need mankind to impose upon the scripture, but it needs mankind to submit to the authority of the word and to trust God knows best. And Heavenly Father, one of the things that you teach us in your word is how to pray. And we now pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from Romans 8 again. We're going to work our way through to the end of the chapter, and then I'm going to call it quits on Romans. Picking up where I left off last week, I'm going to read verses 18 through 27. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated. From his bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we await eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For it is in this hope we are saved. The hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. This is a heavy part of this chapter. The theme of suffering continues in this portion of the verse. I consider that our present sufferings, are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. That translation is different from the translation I memorized this in years ago. In the beginning, in the earliest time of my exposure to this verse, it was the glory that is to be revealed to us. Whereas this says the glory that is to be revealed in us. It's a distinct difference. The glory of God to be revealed in us. Not just to us as those who come into the glory of God. The glory of God to be revealed in us as carriers of the gospel. And yet the context of that is the sufferings once again. Paul writes this gospel in a place of suffering. He himself in prison. And yet, in spite of his circumstance, in spite of his situation, he sees it as an opportunity for the glory of God to be revealed in us. That is good news. Then he goes into an analogy of childbirth. Creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself will be liberated. That's the birth of all that God foresees from the bondage to its decay, brought to glorious freedom of the children of God. That you and I, we are the children of God to which this verse refers. Not only us, but those who have gone before us. Those who have prepared the way for us. We are not alone. But he goes on to say in verse 22, we know the whole creation has been groaning as in pains of childbirth right up to the present time. I have very limited experience with childbirth. First of all, as a male, I have only experienced it as an observer. In the birth of our first child, they had told us that if they didn't use the epidural, that there would be a $500 discount on the bill. And so it was an induced labor, and I was trying to convince my wife that she shouldn't ask for the epidural, that I would give her a new set of golf clubs if she would just hold out. It did not go over well. I won't go into specifics, but she said, I want the epidural and I want it now. But the analogy of the world in childbirth, groaning, awaiting us to come about, to be all that God has called us to be. We have fallen short. But that hope is still there. The hope in us that we will be all that God has called us to be. We are the first fruits, Paul says. And we continue to be first fruits, even though we're 2,000 years later. We continue to be the first fruits as we await our adoption as sons and daughters. Our adoption ultimately, Paul says, is the redemption of our bodies. That which comes only after we die. But it is still our hope. He says that, for in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. We're called to be in waiting in this life. I've heard that Florida described as God's waiting room because so many people come here to retire. But all of us are in the waiting room. We're waiting for the hope that is in Christ, for the fullness of the glory that will be revealed in us. We wait and we hope. And we trust that God will be with us through it all. This pandemic has placed a pall on a lot of life, not only the suspension of so many things that we normally enjoy, but there's been kind of a waiting and expectation on all of us about what lies ahead. God is going to see us through this. There's no guarantee that all of us will make it out the other side. But for those who don't, their hope is fulfilled. We have a hope that does not die. A hope that lives on beyond this life. I would like to say I eagerly await that hope to be fulfilled. But I love this life, and I want to live it as long as I can. Because that hope is still out there. It's still available. There's no reason to rush into the fulfillment of that hope. It'll be there. But it's so important to know. To know with all our hearts that that hope is something worth holding on to. Something worth looking forward to. And we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. Thank God. Thank God that we are not dependent upon our own strength. That the reality of life is that God knows our weaknesses, our fallibility. He even says, we do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes with us with groans that words cannot express. There are times when I can almost feel those Spirit groans in my heart. God intercedes for us. To intercede is to step between. When someone intercedes in the Secret Service on a shooter, for the president or some other official, they get in the way. They take the bullet for them. The Spirit intercedes for us. Gets in the way of that which is holding us back. With groans that words cannot express. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes with the saints in accordance with God's will. God who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit. God knows our hearts. And whatever clutter is there, God knows it. Whatever sin is there, God knows it. And God loves us. Not because of our sin, but God loves us in spite of our sinfulness. There is an idea out there that God is kind of an eternal judge waiting to bring down his gavel on our heads when we mess up. That was the image of God that I had for a long time in my life, kind of an image of Father Time mixed with a judge with a gavel who was just waiting to bop me when I would step out of line. And that image of God was so strong that for a long time, rather than go to God to seek forgiveness, I would kind of avoid God, kind of pretend God wasn't there, that God didn't really know what was going on in my heart and in my life. And in that effort to avoid God, I missed receiving the forgiveness of God so much more quickly than I did. I would go in avoidance and avoidance and avoidance, and then something would always bring me back. And that bringing back was the time that I would surrender and confess. Confess to the sins that God already knew I had committed. But it was so difficult to just accept that forgiveness quickly. I've gotten better over the years of realizing God's there. God's present always. He knows my mind before I know it myself. And he never, ever, ever stops loving us. Regardless of what we've done, God loves us and wants us to come home. That's our choice. He intercedes with us for the saints in accordance with God's will. We're going to talk more about God's will next week because it's a couple of thorny verses that follow this. One great one and then a bunch of thorny ones from my theological perspective. And so we're going to wrestle with those next week right through to the end of the chapter. That is probably the most comforting words of Scripture that I know. I'm going to preview them this morning. Know in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's what we have to look forward to next Sunday. Let us pray. Lord, continue to intercede for us with those groanings of the Spirit. Lord, see us through this process of becoming what you would have us to be, through this process of childbirth that we continue in. Lord, receive us right where we are this day. Thank you for your love and for your forgiveness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn is on page 454. 4, open my eyes that I may see, you may remain seated.
Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep us all now and forevermore. Amen.